Welcome to a lesson on the Huntington-Hill method of apportionment. In 1920, no new apportionment was done because Congress couldn't agree on a method to be used. They appointed a committee of mathematicians to investigate an apportionment method. They recommended the Huntington-Hill method. However, they continued to use Webster's method in 1931. After a second report recommending Huntington-Hill, it was adopted in 1941 and is the current method of apportionment used in Congress. The Huntington-Hill method is similar to Webster's method, but attempts to minimize the percent differences of how many people each representative will represent. To apply the Huntington-Hill method, step one, we determine how many people each representative should represent. We do this by dividing the total population of all the states by the total number of representatives. This answer is called the standard divisor, or just the divisor. Step two, we divide each state's population by the divisor to determine how many representatives it should have. We record this answer to several decimal places. This answer is called the quota. Step three, we cut off the decimal part of the quota to obtain what's called the lower quota, and we'll call this n. Next, we compute the square root of n times the quantity n plus 1, which is the geometric mean of the lower quota and one value higher. Step four, if the quota is larger than the geometric mean, we round up the quota. If the quota is smaller than the geometric mean, we round down the quota. Then we add the resulting whole numbers to get the initial allocation. Step five, if the total from step four is less than the total number of representatives, we reduce the divisor and recalculate the quota and allocation. If the total from step four is larger than the total number of representatives, then we increase the divisor and recalculate the quota and allocation. We continue doing this until the total in step four is equal to the total number of representatives. The divisor we end up with is called the modified divisor or adjusted divisor. Let's take a look at an example. A college offers tutoring in math, English, chemistry, and biology. The number of students enrolled in each subject is listed below. The college can only afford to hire 22 tutors. Using Huntington-Hill's method, determine the apportionment of the tutors. So for the first step, we want to find the standard divisor. So we find the sum of the entire enrollment, which is 780, and we divide by the number of tutors, which is 22. So the standard divisor is approximately 35.4545. And now to find the quota for each discipline, we take each enrollment and divide by the standard divisor. Notice how it's already been done, but let's go ahead and check at least one of them. For math, we would take 380 and divide by 35.4545, which gives us the quota of approximately 10.718. We would do the same for English, chemistry, and biology to get the remaining quotas. And now to find the lower quota, we remove the decimal part of the quota. So we have 10, 6, 2, and 1. From here, we'll find the geometric mean where the lower quota is actually n. We want to find the square root of n times the quantity n plus 1. So to find the geometric mean for math, the first one, we would have the square root of 10 times 10 plus 1, or times 11. So the geometric mean is approximately 10.488. When the lower quota is 6, the geometric mean would be the square root of 6 times 7, or approximately 6.481. When the lower quota is 2, the geometric mean would be the square root of 2 times 3, which is approximately 2.449. And finally, when the lower quota is 1, the geometric mean would be the square root of 1 times 2, which is approximately 1.414. So this is how we find the geometric means. And now for the next step, we want to compare the quota and the geometric mean. If the quota is larger, we would round the quota up If the geometric mean is larger, we would round the quota down. So for math, notice how the quota is larger. For English, the quota is also larger. For chemistry, the quota is still larger. And finally, for biology, the quota is still larger, which means in each case, we'll round the quota up for our initial allocation. So we'll round the math quota to 11. We'll round the English quota to 7, chemistry quota to 3, and the biology quota to 2. Now we'll find this sum and compare it to 22. Notice how the sum is actually 23. It's too high because we only have 22 tutors. So now we'll have to modify the divisor, or in this case, increase the divisor, and then repeat the process. So let's increase the divisor to 37. Notice how the quotas have changed, because now we have to divide the enrollment by 37. For example, for math, we would have 380 divided by 37, which gives us approximately 10.270. For English, we'd have 240 divided by 37, which gives us approximately 6.486, and so on. So again, to find the lower quota, we would remove the decimal part, which would be 10, 6, 2, and 1. Notice how this lower quota is the same as the previous lower quota, which means our geometric mean would actually be the same as before. For math, it'd be the square root of 10 times 11. For English, it'd be the square root of 6 times 7. For chemistry, the square root of 2 times 3. And for biology, the square root of 1 times 2, which, as we saw before, gives us these decimal values here. And again, from here, we're going to compare the quota and the geometric mean. If the quota is larger, we round up. The geometric mean is larger, we round down. Notice this time for math, the geometric mean is greater. For English, the quota is just slightly larger. For chemistry, the quota is larger. And for biology, the quota is also larger, which means we'll now round the math quota down to 10, round the English, chemistry, and biology quotas up. So we'd have 7, 3, and 2. Notice how now when we find the sum of the allocations, it is exactly 22, the number of tutors that we have. And therefore, we're done. This is our final allocation using the Huntington-Hill method of apportionment. I hope you found this helpful.